Here's another thing you need to think about in mining and exploration, episode 5. Today we're talking about check sampling. This really is a bit of a continuation of the previous themes, but we're talking about things like lab umpire testing, or checking PXRF versus laboratory, or talking about fire assay versus photon assay, or half-core versus the other half-core check sampling, right? So where we're going to compare two things, and the idea is that we say something about it, we come up with a conclusion. So to start with check sampling, why are we doing this? The question is the same thing every time. Hint, it's not compliance. You want to learn something about this. But if we start with compliance, yes, it is mentioned in the CIM guidelines, and yes, it is mentioned in the JOR code. So we need to do this. But why are we doing this? We have to come up with some sort of quantitative or qualitative statement about the difference between the two things that we're testing. So as per usual with all these things in this space, we need to start with a data quality objective or a null hypothesis, if you want to speak statistically. We have to know what we're testing at what threshold, otherwise we're going to be stuck in scatter plot gazing universe. And remember from the last video, we don't want to be there. We have to say something about it. Therefore, like with the previous video on twin drilling that I suggest you look at, I'll put the link in the top here, we have to start with proper planning. So when we plan a check sampling program, you have to ensure that the samples are representative of what it is that you're checking. Now that all sounds very simple, a bit of a throwaway comment, but what does it really mean? Now again, I talk about this in the previous video in a lot of detail, but just to quickly capture, it has to be representative of the domain that you're testing. And when I say domain, I'm not talking resource geologist domain. I mean the statistical population that you're testing. Remember, all of these things are nested and there's plenty of things overlapping. So when you're running a testing program or a check sampling program, you have to understand which overlapping populations are there. So for that each of one of those domains, you have representative sampling, right? So that's a really important starting point. Now, the second thing is how many is enough? The same question again, and we get asked this question all of the time, right? Again, all the answers in a previous video, if you want to go in a lot of detail, nothing happens under 30 pairs. 60 is a great place to start for material that doesn't have a lot of heterogeneity. But if you've got some really coarse grain gold, I'd probably look at 100 or maybe even 200 pairs for each domain, okay? So remember that with more variance, you need more N to combat for the variance to be able to see that signal through the noise, okay? Now, if material has changed, so this is important when you're preparing this stuff, if the material has changed, then obviously you're not going to test the same thing. Your conditions have changed. So what can you expect if you're going to test a material that's been oxidizing there for many years? You're going to get a different grade. What are you expecting if the material is very highly hygroscopic, right? So it absorbs all this moisture back in. Things go wrong with the measuring and all sorts of levels. So be very careful. Seabed nodules is a very interesting space to be able to try and get this right because those nodules are very hygroscopic. But also grouping and segregation errors due to transport. If you're transporting your gold pulps on this, you know, corrugated road, and then back at the end, they're just going to scoop at the umpire lab, you know, 30 grams from the top. You're not going to actually test laboratory differences or analytical differences. You're just going to see the sampling error that is made there. So be very careful how you prepare these programs. And the most important thing to remember is please, and everybody does this, which is kind of the sort of the instigator for this video, because please don't use a grade threshold to select these samples, whether it's portable XRF, whether it's CPA versus fire assay, whether it's half core versus another half core, you have to select randomly from your mineralized domains. Right now, I was once there as well until I read an article by Scott Long in 2015. It's in the AIG newsletter, I think. I'll put a link in the description. And I remember when I read it, I was like, oh my God, I do this wrong. And from then on, I changed it. So if you want to go back into detail, then please look at that link there. But what it really is, you have an effect called heteroscedasticity. And what that means is that the variance changes over the grade range. And the simplest way to look at this is if you select duplicate samples or check samples based on the grade threshold, then the original that you select is always above that threshold, but the duplicate of that can come back lower grade. right? It makes intuitive sense. And if you drop that into a scatter plot in your head, then you have this effect that I've drawn here on the screen. Therefore, you're introducing an artificial bias. So please don't select based on the grade threshold. Use your logging code. This is where your logging codes come in handy. So mineralization has been logged by a geologist. Close your eyes, select randomly from that, because you should then also cover the entire grade range. Very important. Now, lastly, as a tip, please insert enough CRMs. Okay, I see this happening all the time because everybody lives in this 1 in 20 space. You have to forget about this 1 in 20 thing. All right, it's about what we're trying to do. So if you're putting 100 check samples in and you're putting 5 CRMs in, 1 in 20, what are you expecting to see? Right, so you need enough CRMs to say something statistically about this. Now, Barry Smee et al., they talk about this in their paper as well, the 2024 paper that I've mentioned a few times. Great resource, freely available. Again, the link is in the description if you want to find it. They talk about having CRMs across the grade range that you're testing. I would go one step further and say, go 1 in 3 or go 1 in 2. You can afford the $500. You're in a mining business. Get it right, because otherwise you're going to get differences between two labs. Warning, that's what will happen. And then you don't know how to benchmark it. So if you have CRMs and enough of them, at least you know where to go with it, which one is different compared to the sort of, you know, fundamental baseline. You know, there's more to it than that as well, again, for another video, but that's the principle. So use maybe 2 or 3 CRMs at a different grade range, right? Low grade, medium grade, high grade, and put a lot in them. Right, because you only do this once every 3 months to really answer a specific question. So pepper that thing with CRMs, okay? Now that brings along a bit of a problem, because the CRM that you used might have already been depleted if you're doing classical fire assay. So now what do we do? Now, Smee et al. Talk about the paper, about a few practical things that you can do. Maybe once in 5, you actually put twice as much CRMs material into one bag so that there's enough material left. You can play with it. I'm not super hung up about that, but there are always practical considerations to think about when you're preparing these programs. And then lastly comes the analysis. Okay, what do you need to do when the data come back? Again, I go to town on this in the twin drilling video. Again, link at the top here. But you have to know what you are trying to prove or disprove. So start with your H0. Otherwise, you're going to just be gazing at a scatter plot, and nobody is prepared in your business to draw a conclusion from that. Yes, you can plot a QQ plot. That's good. Scatter plots and QQ plots are good, but be careful with their interpretation. Also, a non-parametric pair t-test isn't everything, right? So you can use it and it gives you a little bit more statistical foundation, but don't do it blindly. Anyway, these are just some quick tips on how to prepare and how to analyze and how to handle a check sampling program. I hope that's been useful. See you in the next video.